good to see everybody. Nice and, like Joshua said with his little boy, it's nice and toasty in here. We had a birthday on the 18th, Brother Jalen Swan. Sister Faye Clark is celebrating her birthday on today. Reverend John Hines, the 22nd. Sister Barbara Urquhart on the 22nd. God bless you and have a wonderful day.
Day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Amen. Good morning. Good morning, our brothers and sisters and prayer partners. Thank you so much for being here on this third Sunday of July. I know it's moving fast, but they ain't quite moving of January. All right. We also like to welcome everybody that's connected by computer and phone with us, service this morning. Welcome guests, welcome guests. Amen. Jesus says in 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And we want you out there to know that you're listening to Showing the Way, the church that's showing the way, teaching the truth, and striving to live the life. Amen, amen, amen. All right, we don't have any first-time guests today, or any guests, actually. But we did have some birthdays. Brother Jalen Swan celebrated his birthday on Thursday, which was January 18th. And Sister Faye Clark is celebrating hers today, and I'm sure she's listening from Greenville, North Carolina. Amen. Oh, Asheville, that's right. Who's in Greenville? Somebody's in Greenville. Okay, let me make that note. All right. Okay. And we continue to solicit your prayers for Deacon Donna Dre. She's doing fine. She's tested negative of COVID, and hopefully in a few days she'll be back with us. Amen. But keep her in your prayers. Okay. Urquhart family, still lifting them up as well. They haven't recuperated yet, but prayer does change things. And so we know that God is going to send the healing that they all need. All right, let's start our worship. Let us all stand. Come, let us worship God.
Before the Father,
from whom his whole family
in heaven and earth derives his name.
From his glorious riches,
he strengthens us with Holy Spirit power within.
He grounds us in his love.
The love of Christ is so wide, so long, so high, and deep.
Is beyond our ability to grasp.
Grant us, Father, power to know your amazing love.
And fill us completely with your fullness, altogether,
as we worship and praise you.
Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Bow your heads. Father, we thank you for our rest last night and giving us the strength and energy to arise to a new day. Thank you, God, for allowing all of us to travel here safely on this cold Sunday morning. And we're grateful, God. And now we pray that you will allow the Holy Spirit to come and dwell with us as he leads us in worship and in praise. Thank you, God, for the privilege to worship you again in spirit and in truth. All glory goes to you, and we thank you now in Jesus' name. Let us say amen. Amen. as our praise team returns to lead us in praise.
Hallelujah. I am so excited to be in the house of the Lord. Are you excited to be in the house of the Lord today? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Can we just take a moment and just give God the sacrifice of praise, which is the fruit of our lips? So can we just take a few minutes before we even start singing and just worship the Lord right now? Just close your eyes and worship the Lord God Most High. Even lift your hands. As we lift our hands, it is a sign of surrender to the Lord God Most High. So, Father, we just come before you now, Lord. We just posture ourselves right now, Lord. We have a posture of worship before you. And, Father, we just pray that our praise is pleasing to you, Father God. We pray that this is pleasing to you, Lord, and is a pleasing sacrifice being lifted up to heaven. So just worship with us today, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Worship with us.
Baby, my name. storage.
It's empty.
That's right.
Fill me up, Lord.
Thank you.
forever. Amen. And he is good. Real good. Real, real good. Real, real, real good. Real, 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 real good. Yes, he is. Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you so much, praise team. All right. Yeah, let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, at this time, we're going to ask Deacon Nancy Marrick to come now and lead us to the throne of grace. Amen.
Real good. Still good. Amen. That's nothing but the truth. Good morning, saints. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we give you praise, honor, and glory because you are worthy of our highest praise. Sovereign Lord, you are our creator, redeemer, and savior, and we are just in awe of you. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Come magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Thank you, Lord, for your loving kindness, your mercy, and your grace. Father, we know that we have fallen short of your perfect will for our lives, and we confess our sins to you because you said if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Lord, we know that you desire for us to live a holy and righteous life because you are holy. And so we are so thankful, Father God, that you sent your Son to shed his precious blood so that we could be reconciled unto you. And your wonderful Son, Jesus, brought not only salvation and grace, but we also know he said we could cast our cares upon him because his yoke is easy and his burden is light. Hallelujah, and thank you, Jesus. Master, we give you thanks for all the believers here at The Way. We thank you for our ministries, our praise team led by Brother Benson, our beautiful sanctuary, our ushers, and we ask continued blessings on each. Lord, we ask blessings on Pastor John and his helpmate, Lady Janice. They faithfully serve this congregation with love, kindness, and compassion. We also lift up Reverend Hines and Sister Katie. And we ask blessings as well on Reverend Eric Hargrove and Minister Jillian Hargrove. We know that every good and perfect gift comes from you, and our hearts are so filled because we know that this church family has been blessed with you, with the Holy Spirit, and with one another. So we thank you. We ask blessings on any visitors that we may have online, O God, and we pray that their lives will be edified because of the word they hear today. Heavenly Father, we lift up Sister Barbara Couch, who resides in a nursing care facility. We ask that you continue to bless and comfort her and bless her caregivers. There are also sick among us and our extended family. And so we ask continued blessings on Reverend Joe and Sister Bobby Urquhart and family and Sister Bobby's brother, Eddie Randall. We ask blessings on Trustee Selena Gray, Trustee Janet McKenzie, Deacon Donna Dre, Trustee John Blackwell III, and Deacon Lois. We ask blessings and healings upon them, Lord, because we know that you are able. You are the God that for nothing is impossible. And we know that your word says you can cure all manner of disease and illness. We ask also that you comfort those who may have lost loved ones, oh God. We just pray for them and pray for their trust in you. We are also asking blessings and praying for our nation, Lord. Bless us with unity and with peace, and guide us so that we may continue to walk in integrity and be a beacon of light throughout the world. As the prophet Amos said, let justice roll like a mighty river and righteousness like a never-failing stream. Bless our military forces as they fight for freedom around the world. Protect them and comfort them as well as their families. And bless our veterans also, Lord. Bless our first responders for their courage and bravery, as well as their enduring commitment to our safety and welfare. Bless our local and state leaders as they work to improve the lives of all citizens. Lord, we now ask blessings on all world leaders, including our commander-in-chief. May they continue to work for peace throughout the world. Lord, we also ask blessings on the people of Ukraine, Israel, and Palestine. And we pray that your love and compassion will prevail. Lord, as we journey toward that day that has no end, may the joy of the Lord strengthen us. May your power protect us. And may the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide henceforth and forevermore. And the people of God said, amen, amen, and amen.
Say amen. Sister Nancy, Deacon Nancy, thank you so much for that prayer. Thank you so much. Amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Let us continue our worship with our hymn of praise this morning. Oh, I want to see him.
As I journey through the
Amen. All right. At this time, we will continue our worship with our giving as the trustee comes down and our deacon returns to lead us.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
All right, let's go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you again for another extraordinary day that we can come here in this church, the way, the truth, and the life, church, to uplift you and think about you every day and open our hearts. We come with you, to you at this moment to give you praise and to honor your name. With the gifts and givers, we praise you and thank you for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let us all stand. Our ushers will lead us from the rear. Come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Be seated. And we will have the sermonic hymn followed by the word of God.
Praise team. Amen. Amen. Praise team is right. Amen. And the musicians as well. Amen. I can't get over that hymn, that psalm. That's, yeah, it does. Yeah. There's only one who can change a morning into dancing. All of us have experienced mourning before. We have loved ones. All of us have had loved ones to pass on. And we know how we feel. We know it hurts inside. And it hurts for a long time. But within time, God is able to turn our mourning to joy again. That's why the Bible says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. The day will break. The dawn will show up. Our tears will dry.
Yes.
And we're grateful that this song reminds us of that. If you belong to Christ, if God is in your life, if God is not in your life, you will continue to mourn. I promise you that. But when you know the good news of the gospel, that Jesus has gone to prepare a place for us and coming back so we can be where the ones that we've loved have gone on before with them. What a wonderful song. And that morning turns into dancing, into celebration. One more time for us. But it's a time that will never cease. We will always be celebrating and worshiping and praising God. Aren't you glad that you belong to Jesus Christ this morning? Amen, amen, amen. Praise God. All right, let us turn to the book of Matthew, chapter 24. And we're going to begin verses 36 through 39. Then we're going to go to verses 42 through 44. That's the gospel according to Matthew chapter 24, verses 36 through 39. Then to 42 through 44. And it reads from the New King James, "But of that day and hour no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days of before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark, and did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be." Verse 42. "Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming.
Yes.
But know this, that if the master of the house had known, what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect."
Yes.
Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for these precious words. Let those that have an ear hear. Let those that have an ear hear.
All right.
And so we thank you. Now speak to us, God.
Speak, Lord.
Let us know what you would have us to learn and know on this cold Sunday morning. Speak to our hearts as you warm them up. We give you praise, God, for who you are in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to speak to you this morning from the thought, prepare for the unexpected. Prepare for the unexpected. Have you ever been surprised by something you weren't expecting? I've certainly encountered a few surprises in my lifetime. One which stands out, of course, is one that happened to me while I was in Germany. It was a surprise birthday party for me when I was stationed in Germany. My wife had all of my friends to come over to our little apartment and hide in the dark. And when we came home and I flipped the switch, they all hollered, "Surprise!" It was amazing. I was surprised, too. I don't know how she pulled it off without me knowing about it, but she did. What did you say, Deacon? She's smart. Oh, yeah, of course. That's why I married her. I'm just messing. Okay, all right. But I think all of us have been caught off guard at some time or another when something occurred that we weren't expecting. Isn't that right? I wasn't expecting things to turn out this way on my job. I wasn't expecting another child so soon. I wasn't expecting this pay raise. I wasn't expecting my life to be interrupted by this tragedy. And here recently, more and more things are occurring in this world that we weren't expecting, aren't they? In the last few years, we have had some very strong hurricanes. Some of the strongest winds ever recorded. And we have had a constant string of earthquakes, it seems, recently in Colombia and Japan and the Philippines not too long ago. I don't know if you have ever been in an earthquake, ever felt the ground moving under your feet, or feel a building moving while you are in it. It is not a good feeling. I experienced it in Germany. And now we know that there is a massive winter storm hitting parts of the country. Isn't that right? That's why we have so cold in our atmosphere down here in Virginia. And now we know that there is a massive storm. We just don't know what to expect next. And then how can we forget what happened to the country of Israel on October 7th when Hamas militants entered Israel and killed more than 1,400 people at a music festival and took more than 200 hostages, including women and children. And what has been described as the worst massacre of Jews since the Holocaust. And it has drawn the country into a deadly war. But all of this has happened in just the last 4 months in Israel. All unexpected. And then if you want to, you can add an increase in gun violence and crime on our city streets and road rage on our highways. But all of this causes us to ask, what in the world is going on? Well, I'll tell you what's going on. A lot of unusual, strange things that we've never seen before. And all of these bizarre things should put us on notice that we can no longer expect what's normal or what's natural or what's moral or what's sane. We cannot take those things for granted anymore. Actually, we don't know what to expect from day to day, do we? Because crisis is the new norm. I just don't know. But the sad part is many people don't realize that something odd is happening. They don't realize that there is a shift taking place the way things used to be. The way they are becoming and the way they are becoming in nature as well as in the hearts of men. I remember when I was a kid and we would visit my grandmom, and I told you about this many times. We would, after dinner, we wouldn't go in and watch that little black and white TV she had in the living room, but we'd go out on the porch and we would just sit there and talk, and we would watch the cars go by and wave at the cars and say hello to the people as they walk by. Everybody was so friendly. But today, people don't want to talk. They want to text. And if you're sitting on a porch in the wrong neighborhood, you might get shot. And many people seem to be unconcerned. They are just out doing their own thing. Some are out in the world focused, as the Bible puts it, on the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And they are moving further and further away from God. But those of us who are saved and belong to the Lord, we ought to be glad that we heeded the words of Jesus when he said, "Enter by the narrow gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it." Oh, I don't know about you, but I'm glad I changed direction. I'm glad that I realized one day that I was traveling the wrong way. I'm glad I got off the interstate and got on that country road that's taking me home, as John Denver used to sing, taking me home by the way of the narrow gate that leads to life. Are you glad about that? I know you are. But I want you to know that when I talk about this shift, this change that's coming on in the world, I'm not trying to freak you out or try to frighten you to death. No, I'm just want you to understand that things seem to be getting crazy. It's possible that we could wake up one morning to an earthquake or to a nuclear war or in our country without a democracy. So I have come to ask you today, have you prepared yourself for the unexpected? See, it's important that we prepare ourselves, that we are ready in position for whatever may come in this life, because none of us know what's around the corner for us, do we? And we all know you can be here one day and gone the next, or you can be here one day and gone the same day. So when you don't know if you will ever even be included in tomorrow, then being prepared for what might take tomorrow's place is crucial. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Get prepared." And in our text today, Jesus is telling us this very same thing. Now, this is a familiar text for most of us. Most of us have read it before, and I've preached from it before, from a different perspective many, many years ago, but it's time to revisit it again because of the signs of the times. But Jesus is telling us in this text that we need to prepare ourselves for what is unexpected. And what we need to be prepared for is for the time when we have to leave this world. See, when you are preparing to travel by air, we go to the airport ahead of time, and we do that so we can be positioned. We can position ourselves at the airport so when the plane comes in, we can board and depart. It's the same way on the train, at train stations and bus stations. The same process. Now, what's different in leaving by these modes of travel is that there is a departure time that you have to make in advance. I mean, you will be made in advance, be aware of the time that we're going to leave. You're going to leave at the airport. And since you know the departure time, if you need to go and grab a cup of coffee or something to eat, you can do that as long as you get back by the designated time for departure. But when you are about to leave this world, no departure schedule has been given to you. Isn't that right? Therefore, you have to always remain prepared. So when your name is called to board your flight and depart out of this life, you will be ready. And this is what Jesus is telling us in this text. He is letting us know that since we don't know when these things are coming, going to happen, we should stay ready. We should keep our bags packed. So as we examine this text from this 24th chapter of Matthew, here's what's going on. Jesus is having a private conversation with his disciples on the Mount of Olives. And he's talking to them about several different things, about the signs of the time, the end of the age, in the great tribulation and his coming back from heaven one day. And then he begins to tell his disciples that no one knows when he will return. Listen again to what he says in our text beginning with the 36th verse. He says, but of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. His disciples wanted to know a precise time when he would come back, but this was not for them to know. And Jesus tells them in so many words, don't worry about all of that. You just be faithful and be good stewards, but stay prepared in a state of expectancy. And this is what he wants us to understand today, that we shouldn't try to figure out when he's coming back. Just focus on being faithful and good stewards, but stay ready. Then Jesus looks back through history and begins to teach them about the past. And that was good because we all know that the past can teach us some lessons. Isn't that right? I don't know about you, but I have learned some hard and difficult and life-changing lessons from the past. How about you? For one thing, the past is a sharp and clear 2020 vision. You don't need any glasses looking back at your past, do you? But Jesus knew that if people didn't learn from their past mistakes, they would be inclined to repeat them in the future. So Jesus says, but as the day of Noah were, the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were all eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, also will be the coming of the Son of Man be. That Jesus' emphasis here is not so much on the wickedness of Noah's day, because there was plenty of it. That's why God wiped them all out. But his focus was on the people's preoccupation with worldly matters, the ordinary things of everyday life, the eating and drinking and people getting married and partying when judgment fell suddenly on them. Noah tried to warn them by his preaching. And even the ark itself was a testimony to the judgment that was to come. But guess what? They were unconcerned. They didn't care about all of that. In fact, some of them made fun of Noah, like some people today, unconcerned about living for God, serving God, and coming to church, trying to live right and make the world a better place. They just want to do their own thing. They're not looking for God. They're looking for their next drink, their next drugs, their next party, or how to make more money. They weren't concerned about any of that godly stuff. That's the way it was in Noah's day. And Jesus said they were swept away unexpectedly in the midst of their daily world activities. They weren't thinking about a flood. They didn't even believe that they were in any danger. And this makes me think again about all those people who had gathered in Israel for that big concert. They had come from all over their country and from different places in the world to have a good time and to enjoy the music. Surely, they would have never believed in a million years that some sinister Hamas militants from Gaza would attack their music festival, killing some 1,400 innocent people and taking over 200 hostages, including women and children. But it happened. It happened. Yesterday, Johnice and I attended my cousin Pam's funeral virtually that was held in Cleveland, Ohio. She had died suddenly just a few days ago, and every time I looked at her Christmas card after I got the news, her Christmas card to us with her name signed on it, I'm sure she or no one else had any idea that she would pass away so quickly. in just a few days afterwards. But it happened. How many people do you think right now believe that the world will one day come to an end? Or that Jesus is coming back? Although the seasons are changing and the plants and animals can hardly tell one season from the other, and the weather is getting more and more bizarre, like the Bible says, and more wars and rumors of wars are occurring, like the Bible says would happen. How many, just us Christians, the lost people out there, don't have a clue as to what's going on? See, we don't know what the world is going to be like tomorrow, or if tomorrow will even come for us. And in Noah's day, it was just his family and that believed and was spared. And Jesus says the flood came suddenly and took everybody else all away. Those that were not with Noah would all drown. The world's population gone. All swept away. Think about it. All these people unpardoned, unconverted, and unprepared to meet their God. And Jesus says, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Let me tell you, we don't want to be like Noah's generation. We want to be prepared and positioned for the unexpected. But being alert was so important to Jesus that he gives us another warning and example. He says in verse 42 through 44, "Watch, therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming in an hour you do not expect." Jesus was saying each of us is like an owner of a house who is about to be robbed. Not only is the owner unaware of the time of the robber's coming, but he does not even know he's a target. But if he is informed, he will be aware, just as we are aware that Jesus is returning. But still, the owner of the house doesn't know what time the robber might show up, just like we don't know the time Jesus will return, which means we must always, always be ready. Because Jesus says he's coming at an hour we do not expect. Now, I don't know if you ever heard of the phrase timing the market. It's a term that people use to describe jumping in and out of the stock market at designated times, trying to make some money. But the experts say that doesn't work. They say the only way to make money is to be a long-term investor, not jumping in and out. Be long-term. Well, believe it or not, some people try to time Jesus, try to time when they want to live worldly, and try to time when they want to be saved. They say, I'm going out in the world and live the way I want to live now, and then maybe get saved when I get old or just before I die. But let me tell you, there are a lot of people who cut it too close and lost out. Some of them died from a heart attack in a bed they shouldn't have been in. Some got caught up in the drug culture and OD'd. Some got involved in gang activity and got killed. They cut it too close and didn't make it. We have to wonder how many people at that concert in Israel tried to cut it too close. Of those who lost their lives in accidents or hurricanes or earthquakes or wildfires, tried to cut it too close. We have to wonder how many of those people had prepared themselves for the unexpected. See, we have to understand that we can't time Jesus. He is a long-term investment. Because he says he's coming at an hour we do not expect. But I want you to know that it's not only about preparing ourselves for Christ's return. It's also about preparing ourselves for our own deaths one day, if Jesus doesn't come back first. But if we are preparing for his return, it means we will also be prepared for our own transition out of this world into the next whenever it occurs. But I want you to know today, if people are caught by surprise, it won't be because they haven't been warned or that God has tricked them in some way or somehow, but because of their own self-deception or their own not being bothered to be prepared themselves to be ready. But the question that we have to answer, the question today is that how do we prepare ourselves for the unexpected? How do we prepare ourselves for the unknown time of Christ's return and our transition to heaven? How do we prepare for that? Well, that's a very important question, because if we are not prepared for heaven, it means we are going to that other place by default. But it's just two things I want to tell you. First, you need to thank God that you didn't cut it too close. Because all of us have been out in the sinful world at least for a season. That's why the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So we need to thank God for helping us come to our senses and making it back in time. Isn't that right? We need to thank God for giving us time to get off that wide road of destruction and get on the narrow road to eternal life. But the last and main thing I want to tell you is something I've told you many times before. Going forward, we need to make every day count for the rest of our lives. And you might say, how do you do that? Well, let's start with this approach. If you were told you only had a certain amount of time to live, let's just say a month, how would you live it? Most people, when they are told they have just a certain amount of time, they're too sick to do much. But let's just say you are not that sick. What would you do with that money? Well, I believe most people would say, I make every day I had left count. I really would. That's what they would say. But what does a day that counts look like? Because I'm sure everybody has a different perception of what it looks like. Well, some men might feel that spending the day watching football, especially today, during the playoffs, is a day that counts. Or some women might say a day shopping at the mall is a day that counts. I'm sure there's a few in here that feel that way. I won't call names. Or maybe some young people might say a day partying is a day that counts for them. But I have a sneaky suspicion. If we had only a month to live, none of those things would be very important to us any longer. I think the first thing we'd do is to attempt to get our lives in order. I believe we would first try to make sure we were right with God and that we were truly saved. I believe we would try to draw as close to him as humanly possible. I believe nothing would be able to keep us from church. This whole church would be filled. We'd read our Bibles from cover to cover to learn more about heaven, probably constantly being in prayer every day. And then we get right with the people we love. asking forgiveness for the things we've done wrong and show them as much love and affection as we could. I believe we wouldn't let little things irritate us like they do now. We'd be more tolerant of people and kinder as well. And I believe those of us who are Christians would spend as much time as we could trying to influence our children and grandchildren, the rest of our family and friends, to come to Jesus. They hadn't done so. So they could meet us in heaven one day. Yes, I believe if we had just a month left, we would make every day count in preparing to meet our Maker, who is God. Well, if that's the case, why don't we just make every day count right now? Because guess what? We don't know if we have 30 days left or not. It might be more or it might be less. We don't know. But if we make every day count, like I just said, when it's time to leave this world, we'll be prepared to stand before Jesus, not with regrets, but with joy. And you know what? Most of us like that idea. Yes, we want to make our days count. We want to do it because we know it's a good thing to do. In fact, it's a wonderful thing to do, but here's the issue. Here's the problem. We want to start tomorrow, not now. Let me share a little story with you, and we'll be going home in just a few minutes. There were three demons apprentices who were coming to earth to finish their apprenticeship, and they were talking to Satan, their commander in chief, about their plans to tempt and ruin men and women. The first one says, here's what I think we should do. Tell the people that there's no God. Satan says, oh, no, that'll never work. People know there's a God. The second one says, well, how about telling them there's no hell? Satan says again, no, that won't work either. No. Everybody knows there's a hell for sinners. The third one says, what about telling them there is no hurry? Satan says, bingo, go and you will ruin them by the thousands. See, the most dangerous of all delusions and deceptions is that there is plenty of time to turn your life around, plenty of time to get saved, plenty of time to join a church. That's why one of the most dangerous words in our vocabulary is the word tomorrow. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll work on it tomorrow. I can wait until tomorrow. But let me tell you, there are some things which must not be put off, because none of us know if tomorrow will show up for us or not. But we do have today. And I say to all of you, grab it, seize it, use it, live it, and enjoy its every minute and make it count. Make it count by loving God who sent his son, Jesus, into this world to save us. Make it count by loving Jesus who died on the cross for our sins and who is coming back to get us one day. Make it count by loving your family and friends. Make it count by loving yourself and taking care of yourself. Make every day count because it's more valuable than money, silver, or gold, and because no amount can buy another day. And if you make every day count going forward, you will have prepared yourself for the unexpected whenever it occurs. Whether it be when Jesus returns and we are all changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, or if we have transitioned earlier, as the hymn writer puts it, one glad morning. When this life is over, I'll fly away. I'll fly away. Our souls will fly away. So let us all be sure we are prepared for the unexpected. Amen, and may God bless you real good. All right, okay, looks like everybody's saved in here, and everybody is a member of our church. Not quite, but almost. Okay. But it may be somebody listening today on computer or phone, and they don't have Christ, first of all, in their lives, or they don't have a church home. And we can help them in both cases. If you do not have Christ in your life, you need him right away. And so you can do that by calling us by phone, or you can write us here at the church, and we will certainly respond to you. If you would like to be a part of our church, you can do that too by calling us or writing to us. If you want to call us, you can call us at 757-485-3220. That's 757-485-3220. Or you can write us, The Way, The Truth, and The Light Church, Post Office Box 3763, that's Portsmouth, Virginia, zip 23701. Amen, amen. All right, let us prepare to go down. All hearts and minds are clear. Let's go to the Lord. Father God, we thank you for the warning today. Thank you for teaching us that we must prepare ourselves for time that we don't expect. So many people, God, take for granted that things will always be the same, that they will live forever. Everything will always work like it's working today. So, God, I pray that you speak to their hearts, not necessarily the people in this place, because we're all saved. We are already in position, God. We're already prepared and continuing to be prepared. But there's so many people think that every morning they're going to wake up. So many people that think that sickness is for somebody else, not for them. So many people that believe that they can always live forever. Wake them up, oh God. Let them see the light, we pray. There's going to come a time when everything will end. And if your son, Jesus Christ, is not in their lives, they will never be able to receive the joy after their mourning. They will never be able to celebrate where their loved one is gone. Touch their hearts today, wherever they are in this world, in this community, in this city, oh God. So many lost people walking around, moving in our midst, even some maybe in our own homes or families, God. I pray now that you will touch their hearts. Let somebody say a word to them to encourage them. And so we thank you for this message today. Thank you for your word. Now continue to bless our church, we pray. Continue to ask that you will send all of the healing Sister Donna needs and the Urquhart family and the others that are having difficult health problems, oh God. We pray for all of them that you will turn their cases around. And so we just thank you for this day. We thank you for the privilege to come together one more time as a family. We rejoice in seeing each other and knowing everybody's doing okay. So we thank you for our family. Continue to allow us to walk with you, God. Continue to order our steps by your word. Continue to speak to our hearts, encourage us, and bless us. So we give you praise and thanks. Now to the church, we pray that the Lord will continue to bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace now and forevermore. And let the church say amen till we meet again. Thank you. Thank you.